Good morning, Mesa. The scripture we will be reading is from John 15, 12 through 17. John 15, 12 through 17. This is my commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that one lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you slaves, for the slave does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends, for all the things that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. But did not choose me, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you, that you should go out and bear fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatever you ask of the Father in my name he may give to you. This I command you, that you love one another.
Thank you, Tim. It's good to see everyone this morning. I know a lot of you have been sick, and I want to say thank you for sharing. It's just that time of year, isn't it? I'm doing better. At least I'm here. So lots of good things that are going on. I'm excited about Wednesday night. That's going to be great. We're going to be able to go and actually give gifts to people that we don't know yet, but we'll get to just see them. Don't everybody flood into their house, but just go in the yard and say hi, Merry Christmas, and give them the gifts, and that'll be a good thing for us to be able to do. So that's going to be a great thing, because there's been so many people who have given good things for them, and it's always good to be able to do that. We did have a baptism last week. Darius Wickware. Darius, where are you? There he is. All right, good to see you. So be sure you talk to Darius and get to know him a little bit. He lives in the neighborhood, and we're just really excited. He was very, very passionate about coming to Christ and really wanted to do that. So that was exciting. All right, so today we want to talk a little bit about uncommon love and what that means. I started to define it, but everybody knows what that means, right? Some people know how to love and some people don't. And the ones who know how to love is us, and the ones who don't is other people. It's very simple. See, that's just the way it works. And so when you think about that, we all have different backgrounds. We've been through different things, and some of us grew up in very loving, nurturing families. Some not so much. They didn't have that kind of love or nurture when they started. Hopefully they've found it later, but we all develop different things, and we all think we're the ones that's normal. Everybody else we're not sure about. When we look around, love's been very commercialized. We use it to sell things. We love this. We love everything from cat litter to, you know, whatever it is you want to put on the next one. And so love is also about sex. If you have sex, you obviously have love. If you don't have love, then, yeah, you get the picture. Love is used to manipulate people. If you watch TV shows, I mean, I love you is sometimes a very scary thing. Love is more about how I feel. And so I love you until I quit feeling this way. And if I, you know, ever don't feel the same way, then obviously we're out. We don't love each other. Those are not how Jesus describes it. Our normal way of love looks something like this. Nice couple, right? They look so good. She's all dressed up. He's all dressed up. Everything's good. They're in the city. And we love someone who loves us. How do you know? Well, when they love us, you know, you make eye contact, right? I don't know. How do you know if somebody loves you? Make eye contact or something and says, okay, that must be the one. Love at first sight. You know about that? We've seen a person. Hey, I think I love that one. I'm not sure that that's really valid. I think that might be more glands than anything else. But we build a connection on things like that. We say, oh, well, we have this connection. We do so well together. And we think that that's going to last for a long time. And we love them because they love us until they quit loving us so much and we quit loving them so much. And then when we don't love each other anymore, we call it quits because, well, it's obviously the other person's fault because they didn't love us. And so that's why it failed, is they didn't love us. Odd thing is it happens with kids as well. Kids grow up in a family and, you know, they're loved and cared for and everything most of the time. And then you find sometime they start arguing back. They start talking back. They start doing all kinds of things that aren't quite what you wanted to happen here. And so what happens then? And they even decide, you know what, I don't want to be part of this family anymore. I think I'm going to leave. And so eventually they go, hopefully with the blessings of the parents, but sometimes not. They decide there's no connection for us anymore. And this whole idea of connection is what we care about the most. They don't get us. They don't let us do what they want. So we decided that it isn't love anymore. And so we break. And that happens over and over again in our world. The divorce rate is way up there. I mean, well over 50%. It's like 75 now. There are times when we get where we wonder whether it's worth it. And I see more and more people today just deciding, well, I don't think I want to get married anymore because people just get divorced. Well, yeah, you would have to be married in order to get divorced. The trouble with that statistic is the ones who don't get married don't stay together either. They end up splitting. It just makes it easier because we know we're not going to be committed. We know we're not going to stay. So we might as well just go ahead and set it up to divide. And I'm not sure we ever started that way in the first place. So that's our world. What does Jesus look like? What can we look at as far as what Jesus talks about in his world? Because I think we need to look at what he has to say about love more than anything else. So the passage that Tim read to us this morning, it's not love relationship between a husband and a wife or parents and children, but it's a love relationship that talks about Jesus and his love, and I think it's a pattern that gives us for everything. So they're in the upper room before the crucifixion, and Jesus has told them about the branches and the vine, and that, you know, you abide in me and you're connected to me, and the reason the world doesn't like you is because of me. And so they're going to hate you. And so this comes right on top of him, of that idea that the world is going to hate you. And then he says, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Not as long as it's still good. But he says, I want you just to love one another. Now they've been 3.5 years to be able to get to this point. And this is a different commandment. Always before it was love as you would want someone to do for you. No, this is love the way Jesus does. And that's a very different extent. It doesn't depend on whether you like them or not. It says just decide you're going to love them. That's really what it's more about. Just decide that's what's going to happen. I'm decided I'm going to love. It saves a lot of time. You don't have to evaluate, do I like this person? Do I not like this person? Are they okay? I don't know about them yet. I mean, they seem kind of weird to me, so, you know, I'm not really sure about them. But it's one of the hardest things you'll ever do, is just to be able to decide, I'm going to just go ahead and love this person. You love regardless of how they treat you. Are they going to tell you how to love? They're going to decide for you? Why don't we decide on our own? I think that's what Jesus did, isn't it? Didn't he decide, I'm going to love this person? Didn't he decide? I think we can do that too. He says, I want you to love the same way I did, not based on whether they're lovable, on whether they're nice today, on whether they're having a good day, but I want it to be based on the fact that I decided to love them. And that's what Jesus did, is he just decided to love us. We didn't deserve anything. We didn't deserve to be loved. In fact, we were kind of enemies. But he said, I'm going to start loving you. And then he says, greater love is laying down your life for your friends. It's not when it's convenient for you. It's when it costs something. And we're very familiar with this. Because we talk about war and we talk about times when people would go and give a great sacrifice. And they would be able to go, and because they care about their country, for love of their country. And we appreciate people like that who are willing to make that kind of a sacrifice for us. And so when we see things like that, we understand they are laying down their life for us. And it does make a difference. And Jesus is also the one there who is laying down his life. He understands as he's saying this. This is the greatest love, that I'm going to lay down my life for my friends. Right? Friends. No, it's always been servants. It's always been disciples. And now he starts calling them friends. It's taken 3.5 years to get to be the friend status. Because now they understand him. Now they know what he's about. They know what he's doing. Friends are people, he says, who do what Jesus commanded. Well, we don't like that. What do you mean I have to do what you command? How many friends give you commands? Probably not many. If you think about it, they really do all the time. It's called favors, right? You can't really get out of it. You have to do it because, after all, they're a friend. And what kind of friend would you be if you didn't do it? We don't call it commands today. But we understand them. We know what it is. We understand what they're all about. We understand this is something that they need. And so, of course, excuse me. Of course we're willing to do that. You may get those every once in a while just because that's the way it is today. So we call them friends. And he says, friends are people who know what's going on. Friends are people who are there because they have heard what the Father has revealed. He says, I've explained to you everything about it. Because you're going to tell friends about what's going on in your life. And he says, I'm doing that with you. I've told you everything about what the Father wants to do. I've told you exactly how he wants to be. And so that's what he's trying to describe here. Is he's talking about how he taught them, how he trained them, how he developed them, how this whole attitude and thinking comes from Jesus. Because they didn't start out like this. They didn't start out in any way, shape, or form to be like they are now. But they have come a long ways. And they don't think they're ready yet, but Jesus is trying to say, no, it's time. You're ready. And he says, I've appointed you to go and bear fruit. I want you to be able to go and bear fruit. I want you to go and be able to teach other people. I want you to go and take the message I've got and be able to share that with a lot of others. Because that's going to make all the difference. And I also want that fruit to last. I want it to remain. I want it to abide. Different versions have different words there. The Greek word is meno, and it actually means to continue, to stay, to abide. And so that's what he's trying to describe here. It's not something that is a matter of, well, okay, we went and, you know, they were converted, and then, well, they're gone. We don't know what happened. No, he says, I want them to stay. And so that fruit remains. And it's kind of easy to blame the fruit, right? Because we can say, well, you know, they just weren't committed then, right? So it's not us. I think we need to work on this one. When our orange tree gets the little green buds on it, you know, you think, man, this is going to be great. Look at all those little oranges on there. This is going to be a great year. Until several weeks later when all of a sudden you find these little green things all over the ground. You're going, what happened? That was an orange. That could have been an... Yeah, forget it. It decides how much oranges it can hold on a branch. And if it didn't do that, it wouldn't work. That's not how we want to have Christians. Because fruit is only what stays on the branch. You don't have fruit that fell off. That's really not fruit. It's got to be called what stays on the branch and so that it remains. And he says, I've given you a message. I've given you a way to tell those parables and those stories about Jesus so that it makes a difference in people's lives, so that you heal broken lives. He says, love is about that. Friends are about that. And that's what I came to be able to give you. And so that's what he does with all of this. Whatever he says, the next thing is whatever you ask in his name, he says, the Father will grant it. You ever had an open wish like that? Whatever you want. Now understand that he's going to do whatever's best. Not whatever you want, but he's going to say, this is what's best. So what do you need? Talk to him. I think it's whatever you need in doing this sharing that you're going to be doing. I've appointed you to bear fruit, and whatever you need to do this, then certainly the Father will answer. But do we even talk to him about it? And then he says, I'm commanding all these things so that we will love one another. Because we're all working together. We're all in this together. And so that's kind of what Jesus describes as his commandment about loving. And so to put it all together, we love regardless of how the other person feels. We're friends of Jesus who share his love. Jesus shows us what God is doing. He invites us to join in the work that he's doing. He gives us a place and power to accomplish by saying, you go bear fruit. It will happen. And we treat them in a way that makes them stay as disciples. It's incredible to watch how that process works. And as you read about the early church, you read about a lot of different times where they were able to share with each other. And we have that kind of statement made in the early church as they loved each other and cared for each other and shared with each other. They weren't trying to take advantage of each other. They were genuinely trying to love each other with that. And I found an article of how they loved in a very huge way. It says, there's one more thing that's very much characterized the early church. It was concern for those who had been discarded. Let me give you an example. The world of the Roman Empire was often characterized by infanticide. That is the killing of infants. Primarily, it was the discarding of female infants that was characterized in the Roman Empire. Females were not valued as much as males, so it was not uncommon for a Roman family that if a wife gave birth to a little girl, that little girl was taken out to the dung heap on the edge of town and left there to die of exposure. We actually have a letter written in 1 BC by a Roman named Hilarion, who wrote to his pregnant wife these poignant, disturbing words. Hilarion wrote, if you deliver of a child before I return home, if it's a boy, keep it. If it's a girl, discard it. You see, the early Christians lived out their faith in these practical, tangible, obvious kinds of ways. I'm reminded of the fact that these little girls, for example, who were discarded on the dung heaps, what would happen is that Christians in the community would climb through the refuse, the garbage, and they would rescue those little girls. In some cases, little boys who were born with deformed limbs. And they would rescue those little children and raise them as if they were their own. The pagan world had never seen anything quite like this. In fact, it actually disturbed the Emperor Julian to see how this kind of activity. If you want to know why Christians expanded, one of the big reasons is their compassion for the discarded and their compassion for the poor. That's what makes all the difference. It's when people are able to love like that. Did they have to do that? Not at all. They don't have to do anything. They don't even have to be nice. But if that's your attitude, I'm surprised you made it this morning. Love. We are surrounded by people who really don't know how, and who are ready to give up on most relationships that they get into. It's just the way it is today, and we accept that. That's normal, right? That's not Christ. Because he seems to make permanent, lasting relationships. And so what if he decides to give up on you? If you decide, well, I don't think I love him as much today, he'll decide, I don't think I love them either. And what happens? Pretty soon the break happens. Oh, no, but we want to say, Jesus, you can't do that. You're not allowed to. Now, we can do that, but you can't do that. You'll always be there. And then we come back, and you'll love us just the same. It breaks relationships when that happens. See, we've got to love on purpose. We've got to love because we decided this is who we want to be. It's not just a matter of if they're nice or if they're friendly or if they're kind. Now, it does make it easier if you're lovable. Understand that. So that might help. But at the same time, what really speaks of the love of Christ is maybe somebody who desperately needs it but turns it down every time because they don't think they're worthy. They don't think they're good enough. And we see that kind of thing over and over again. One of the hardest statements that Jesus says is found in Matthew 5:43. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and he sends rain on the just and the unjust. If you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even tax collectors do the same? And if you do greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? You therefore must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. And understand the perfect there is not exactly what we would think of as perfect. It's not sinless. It's you must be mature. You must be complete. You must be full grown about this because love isn't a matter of perfection. Love does have a lot of stages. Immaturity, though. And that's what happens. You see little kids, I love you, until they don't get their favorite dessert. And then I don't love you anymore because I like my dessert. And, well, that's not really love, is it? So Jesus here poses a whole other dilemma of how we do this. And he says it's not really based on the other person's behavior, and it's not based on whether they're nice or not, and it's not based on whether they do anything for you or not, and it's not based on whether you call them friend or enemy. This one's hard. That's why this is uncommon love. See, we spend a lot of our time deciding who's the enemy. And he says, don't make a distinction. Love everyone, enemy or friend. Pray for those who persecute you. They don't know what they're doing. Does that sound familiar? Jesus from the cross. They don't know what they're doing. They don't know that they're harming a child of God. They don't know that God's going to punish that. They have no clue or idea what they're in for because you're a child of God. So he says, love, do good, bless, pray for. Love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who mistreat you. Love those who love you is not Jesus' kind of love. Certainly love those who love you, but love those who don't love you as well. Does it mean you have this warm, fuzzy feeling about them? I don't think so. But it might mean you're going to do something that's best for them, whether you like it or whether they like it. You're still going to do something that's best for them. And I think that's really what it comes down to. If you greet only your brothers, he says, everybody does that. That kind of love is easy. That kind of love is very common. He said, I want you to be mature like your heavenly Father is mature. And then he even describes it. He talks about the rain and the sun, and he sends those on everybody. You realize he could put a cloud just right over you. You know, and everybody who's bad gets only rain, and everybody who's good gets only sun. Well, it's Arizona. Everybody's here, right? So that's what happens. We get only sun. Immature love is getting what I want. I love you because you're pretty. I love you because you do good things for me. I love you while it's good for me. And all of those kinds of things. It's all about self. Maturity in love is doing what's best, and neither one may get what they want. But it's what's best. And that's what makes all the difference. In 1 John, he talks about love casts out fear. There's no fear in love. But perfect love casts out fear. Fear of harm, fear of loss, fear of rejection. Those things still seem to be part of most people's love. But if you go with the way Jesus looks at it, you don't have to worry about those because you've already been rejected before you even started. So you're going to love an enemy. And it's already decided that way. You don't lose anything when they hate you. Because we end up worrying about, well, do they like me? Do they love me? Do they, you know, what are we going to do here? We're so afraid either way. So let me give you some ideas on this. Something I read recently is what troubles you in this life. And they came up with two things. One is someone has offended you, including yourself. Sometimes we're offended at ourselves. We feel or fear a great harm. And those who offend us are called enemies. And the offense of the enemies we call evil. And what else troubles us is someone who loves and cherishes us, and so we fear loss. What if they don't continue? We love those people who are friends, and the love of friends we call is good. Both will enslave you. Enemies come in two different disguises. Both fuel your fear. And we want to control our world and we want to protect ourselves from them by overcoming them. The first enemy is an enemy within yourself. It might be an enemy of addiction. It might be food. It might be substance. It might be activity. Your body doesn't work or look or function like you want. And so you do all kinds of things to make up for it. You do all kinds of things that says, well, you know, I'm going to be this way. I'm going to do that. Maybe it's I want more money. Maybe it's a battle to fix the problem, fix ourselves as the problem. And we fall into battles of self-loathing where we don't like ourselves. We don't feel good about ourselves. You look at yourself in the mirror, you say, oh, my goodness, I'm so glad there's paint. I can put it on and I won't look like I really look, because after all, if we looked like we really looked, nobody would like us, right? And so that's why we get all prettied up before we ever go out in public. We don't want anyone to see us like we really are. And so we put on the disguise. And we despise God's creation. He made you unique. He made you different from everybody else on purpose. But we put on stuff that makes us all look the same, right? So we'll look like everyone else. The second enemy is outside of yourself. It might be a neighbor. It might be a friend. It might be a monster. So we build up walls to protect ourselves. And we learn to attack in self-defense sometimes. And so it's all because we're afraid. What's going to happen? Okay, what is going to happen? Well, they might come and they might harm us. Could be. What's the worst they could do? They could kill us. They could. And then what happens? We go to heaven. Sounds like a big problem, doesn't it? So I'm not sure the fear is really justified there. We're not maybe ready to leave this life yet. We don't want to leave this life yet. But what are you going to hang on to? Jesus says when you learn to love like this, you let go of the things of this world. Because those are not what's most important. And you've got to be able to get past those. Because then there's no way that they harm you. We fear because we're in this old selfish flesh system rather than having a true identity in the kingdom. And that's really what it's got to be about. Overcoming enemies is two ways. First is let go of the earthen vessel. Decide this is not what's important. Do I get harmed? You might. You might. Number two is love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Don't judge. Don't resist an evil man, expecting nothing in return. Turn the other cheek. And he says, you'll be sons of the Most High. That's what he says. Accept who you are as sons of the Most High. Don't accept that, well, I'm an enemy of that guy. No, I'm a son of the Most High. And when you go to him as a son of the Most High. Don't go to him as a guy who's been hurt and wronged and therefore has a grudge. But go to him as the son of the Most High. Because that's who you are. Claim that identity over any of the other ones. Accept who you are in that world. And friends can pose the same issue. I know, that's not supposed to make sense. This is all about enemies. That's the hard part. Now, sometimes your friends are just as difficult. I don't know if we realize that or not, because we like our friends and we cling to what our friends give us, because our friends make us feel good about ourselves. Our friends give us all this affection and attention, and we fear the loss of that affection and attention. And if they don't give us that same affection and attention, well, we wonder what's wrong. They might not like us anymore. That would be terrible. Why? Well, because we feed on that liking that they give to us. And if they just like us and tell us we're great and tell us we're wonderful and we're so important in their life, well, then we feel good about that. So they become the master. Because we like to feel good about ourselves, and they make us feel good until they don't. And then, well, we just need new friends, right? And so we move on to the next one. Most of what we call love is little more than addictive clinging. Affection makes us feel good about ourselves. And when that person fails us, we feel wounded and angry. And addictive clinging is not love. Why did you have to stop loving them? I mean, yes, they behave badly, but why did you have to stop loving them? Well, if they don't love me, I'm not loving them. That's real mature. And we're back to the same thing. Jesus says, I want you to love like I do. And it's a very mature love. There's no fear of loss in love, because love doesn't seek its own. So why do we feel so wounded when a friend fails us? Because a lot of us put our identity and our meaning in them, and we feel failed when it goes bad, like it's us that's failed. And we need to not place our identity or meaning in them, but in Jesus, because he's the one that makes the difference. Every single thing you put your real trust in that isn't Jesus, that gives you meaning, that gives you significance, is going to be a battle for you. But when you learn to love like that, like Jesus does, it makes all the difference. And so the world offers a Savior in the form of relationships. We hear that all the time. Relationships, relationships. That's what everybody wants, is relationships. And they go through tearing up one after another, after another, after another, because, well, they love me. Oh, no, they don't anymore. Well, they love me, but no, not anymore. Well, they love me because, well, we've had problems. Well, they love me, but... And we keep going through these things, trying to find a relationship. And they said, oh, if you could find the right relationship, you'd be happy. I agree. And the right one is with Jesus, because he's the only one who doesn't start with the fact that, oh, you love me? I love you. I think you're great. You think I'm great? Well, I think you're great. I think you're greater. Oh, I'm so glad you think I'm greater. And we do this round and round, back and forth, until we say, no, not so much. I don't think you're very good today. You're not even being nice to me. I don't know what's wrong with you. And we get all this battle going on. The deception is it cannot give us meaning, significance, or identity in a relationship other than in Jesus Christ. And when you start putting your trust and your love into a relationship other than with him, then we start finding that other person starts to say, well, no, you don't need Jesus so much. We either align ourselves with God or we align ourselves with the other person. You can't serve two masters. And Jesus started loving us while we were enemies, right? For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Not only enemies, but ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more now we are reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. Jesus loved us when we were weak and ungodly and sinners and completely against him and didn't want anything to do with him. And he said, I'll start. I love you. And we said, no. But I love you. No. I don't want that. And he never changed. He says, I'm going to be the person who loves you. I don't care what you do. I don't care how far you go. I don't care how terrible you think we are, or how terrible you think you are. I'm just going to love you. And that's what happened a lot. We went through all kinds of other relationships until we finally got the message, maybe it's me. And we decided, I think I'm terrible. Because I'm not, it's not working, it's not going, it's not, everybody doesn't think I'm perfect, I don't understand why. And so then we come back to the only person who says, I love you. I don't care what you've done, I don't care how far you've been, I love you. If you just come to me, it will make all the difference in your life. Doesn't change his. He sits in heaven waiting. He sits there because just at the right time when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ugly, for the terrible, for the awful, for the horrible, for those people who had destroyed their life so much that no one else would be there, for those people who killed him on a cross, for the ungodly. And he shows us how to live by his life. So does God love you today? I hope you know that answer is yes. Are you here because you love him? Have you shown him? Have you told him? He explains in chapter 6 of Romans about baptism into him, and that's where we touch his blood, and that's where all of that process. And while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God. And he says, I have this message of love for the world. While you're enemies, go tell them how much we love them. If you haven't come to that kind of love yet, maybe you need to improve it a bit. And so maybe you either start by coming to Christ in the first place and repenting and being baptized into him, or maybe it's, you've already done that and you say, yeah, it's still not working. Maybe the place you need to start is with you and start loving yourself. And then maybe with an enemy. If we can pray for you today or help you today, please come while we stand and sing.